If nothing dramatic is done, the river's pretty much a dead river.
From the seat of a raft, the Rio Grande may look strong and alive, but this river is sick. Humans demand massive amounts of water to drink and irrigate crops. The river is deluged with sewage and trash. Invasive trees and plants continue to choke this once mighty river. But still, the Rio rolls on. These eighth graders from London School in Corpus Christi are on their first ever rafting trip.
Whoa!
Most have never seen this river, and none fully comprehend its struggles. But by the end of the day, they will. This river has lessons to teach for all those that are willing to take the time to learn. It's early in the morning, and outfitters prepare for a float down the Rio Grande.
One, two, three.
The students from London School gear up for the adventure.
I think it's gonna be cool. I can't wait to do it. It's gonna be fun.
Okay, watch your step.
I don't know, I've never done it before. I'm up for a new experience.
I think it might be a little hard, just like not knowing what to do.
All back, does everybody paddle backward at the same time? It's really important to paddle together.
Yeah, just step over these guys so they can stay right there and everybody can work around them.
This is our backyard. We're very proud of it. There's a lot to offer. We have experienced this year some of the best water we've seen in 7 or 8 years.
All right, all forward. Dig on in.
This water that's so good for rafting is the same precious resource that millions of people who live along the Rio Grande count on for survival.
Pretty much vanishes. It gets used for irrigation. Colorado uses a heap of it.
And that has river guides like Gonzo preaching to his paddlers.
And the bottom line is we're running out of water. This river's dry a lot of the time of the year. It's a wild and scenic river. It seems kind of odd that a wild and scenic river wouldn't be a river any longer.
Water, of course, is the lifeblood of our farm.
Fred Schuster is one of many farmers who count on water from the Rio Grande to keep his operation running.
Here you're seeing a very healthy honeydew melon crop. We're about a week to 10 days away from harvest.
Schuster grows 32 different fruits and vegetables and relies on the Rio Grande to irrigate all of them. But when severe drought hits, like it did in 2002, when the Rio Grande didn't even reach the Gulf of Mexico, farm operations like Schuster's were left high and dry.
We quit growing cotton, quit growing grain, corn during the summer just to try to save all that water for winter vegetables.
2002 was a very difficult year for our farmers in the area. Our reservoirs dropped to among the lowest levels they had been in a long time. But yet we know the resilience of the Rio Grande. Just 2 years later, the U.S. reserves are back to 100%. We know that that's only temporary, though. We know that drought is part of the nature of living along the Rio Grande, and we know we will have scarcity again.
We don't look at it by the gallon anymore. We look at it by the drop, and we want to make every drop count when we go to utilize that for production.
The students and parents from Corpus continue to enjoy their trip down the Rio Grande.
Everyone high five with your paddles.
With new lessons past every rapid.
These trees, the bushy ones along the shore, do you remember what they're called? The really soft looking ones, the ones that are dominant down here. There is water sucker. Some people call it a salt cedar. It's called a tamarisk.
In the upper part of the Rio Grande in Texas, it has basically replaced all of the native trees that were once along the river.
This is the entrance to Colorado Canyon. We have a project started here to eliminate the salt cedar along the Rio Grande.
Introduced over 100 years ago, salt cedar now completely consumes the riverbanks.
It's a kind of a thicket, a jungle. You got to get into it, inside it enough to where you can come in and cut some of the larger branches out. That's a good one. Then once we get it all pulled out and cleared, we're going in on the fresh cuts and putting a herbicide on it.
We don't want to wipe out everything. We want to be selective in what we're removing.
And we're digging holes and planting what we call cottonwood and willow poles. They're about 4 to 6 feet long. Hopefully within a year or so they'll root. Give it about 2 or 3 years, maybe we'll have some trees out here.
There isn't much plant diversity along the Rio Grande, and the same can be said for the aquatic life.
Figured we'd work this area right here.
Biologists conduct fish surveys using electroshock equipment, and the statistics are scary.
About 85% of all the state-listed threatened and endangered species come from the Rio Grande Basin.
Poor reproduction, a lot of adults aren't here. The numbers are just down. Species diversity is down. All of these indicate a sick river.
No luck.
Even though the river is sick, it still provides plenty of excitement for the students, as there is just one more rapid to run.
All forward, dig in, keep digging, keep digging. Woo-hoo, nice.
Well, this river trip has finally come to a close as the students head for the takeout.
We're gonna hit y'all.
And as it turns out, the kids got more out of this trip than just the thrill of running the river.
It was a lot of fun, and we learned a lot about like the different kind of rocks and stuff like that from our science teacher.
The diversity down here is just awesome. I would say Big Bend is definitely the perfect outdoor classroom.
When does it show that the first amphibians appeared?
The Devonian.
During the Devonian period.
I guess when you're in a classroom, everything just seems more boring since you're just sitting down listening to a teacher talk. When you're out here being active, like canoeing and hiking and having fun with your friends, everything just seems more interesting.
I've learned about certain plants out here in Big Bend and like how the water flows of the Rio Grande and where it started.
And maybe now these students will have a better appreciation for this river and its water.
A lot of us have often stated that every drop counts, and it really, really does. And I think the next generation will come in with a greater awareness that we do need to protect these natural resources because they are finite.
We're all in this together, and not any one of us is more important than anybody else. So we need to work together to preserve this river and this source of water.
Hopefully the next generation will understand what might be lost here. Hopefully the next generation will step up and do the right thing and do what they can to save it.
All right, take a breather.